things that aren't there anymore. Before bus service took over completely, around 1950, we depended on the neighborhood streetcars to get around. Like this number three car, the old Grant Street trolley, which would shake from side to side as it wound through West Side streets and alleys to downtown Buffalo. Main Street was the focal point for shopping, entertainment, dining, and nightlife, and the street was always bustling with activity, daytime or evening, and our neighbors to the north were a great part of that scene.
Canadian shoppers could come over not simply on the weekends, but also during the week. It should be remembered at that time that the stores were not open on Sundays and at the most might be open until noon on a Saturday. So that the Canadian shopper would be in Buffalo during the week to do shopping, but then in Buffalo on the weekend for the entertainment venue.
Since Crystal Beach and Buffalo were interwoven both with people and the good times enjoyed by both sides of the border, a favorite of many people from this a favorite time was to take the boat or the bus from Crystal Beach to the downtown area when downtown Buffalo was really something.
Shelton Square was there, which people forget about, which is a beautiful square. And unfortunately, this is one of those tales, but we always would have to stop in the washrooms because we'd been a long time on the way sometimes. But we always would go through Shelton Square on the way back to Commercial Street to get on the boat.
In those days, the retail business in Buffalo was all downtown. You had, just to name the stores we were talking about, A&A, Hanger, Hens and Kelly, E.W. Edwards and Company. You had Richmond Clothes, Bond Clothes, Klein Hands, Jacoby Brothers, Martin Jacoby Men's Stores. You had L.L. Burger. You had Oppenheim and Collins, and the women's wear stores, both fine stores.
Downtown Buffalo was always very exciting for me as a kid, whether I took the bus alone after I was old enough. Actually, I remember working at Meisner's as a young girl. I worked in the unmentionable department.
The shopping was always fun, especially at holiday time, Christmas time, when your mother would bring you down and you'd go see the Santa Claus. And at one store, I believe it was the Hengerer store, you could even get an advance Christmas present. Your mother, of course, had to pay for it. It was probably 25 cents. But that was incentive enough to go downtown and to see Santa Claus.
Oh, I used to love Hengerer's. It was such a classy place. I would go in there. I never had a whole lot of money to spend, but after working at Meisner's, I'd save a little bit and go in there, maybe buy myself a scarf or a little piece of jewelry, or cologne then wasn't what it is now, and I always enjoyed going in there.
There were trolley cars that went down Main Street along Hurdle Avenue and a number of the other streets as well, and it used to cost 3 cents to take the bus from where I live in Kenmore into the city line, and another 3 cents downtown.
You know, it was always downtown. Why not uptown? Well, regardless, downtown Buffalo always tempted us to stop in for a bite. Yes, food. And lots of it, from dozens of eating establishments ranging from nut shops and lunch counters to great restaurants. And the price was right.
There was the McDowell's restaurant on Main Street, I think it was Main and Chippewa. And we had Lobby's Old Spain, which was on Main Street, and Lobby's Cafeteria, which was at Shelton Square.
Lobby's Old Spain's still there, but it's a Swiss Chalet today. And at that time, to walk in like you were in a little Spanish household.
Well, it was December the 8th, 1945, and I got married out in Hamburg, and then we drove downtown to Lobby's Old Spain to have dinner. And this menu I have is a souvenir menu. It says on the envelope. So I kept it all these years. Oh, that deluxe dinner. Imagine a whole dinner from soup to coffee, $1.35. The luncheon was 65 cents if you got there from 11 to 4:30.
Then I had a little job in the Ellicott Square building. And when I worked on Saturday at lunchtime, I'd run across the street to Hugh's restaurant. And they had the greatest deli sandwiches. There was about that much deli meat in there. And they had great chili, and the prices were ridiculously low. And the press hung out in there. I'd run into reporters and see people with their cameras hanging on their shoulders and so forth. And again, all this was exciting. I did go to Dan Montgomery's. I had steak dinner there. A date took me there after a dance. And I remember the women had long dresses on when they would come to take our orders. And they were mostly black and very attractive and very gentle. It was quite an experience for me.
158 Exchange Street, I remember the number. It was quite a spot, and it had beautiful decor, of leaded glass, quite prominent all through the place, and antique furniture in there that it was almost priceless, you know. I don't think anybody could say anything detrimental about Dan Montgomery's place. It was terrific.
On other occasions, when I was downtown, I would go to a theater with my aunt, and then we'd have lunch at McDowell's. They had this drum bar in McDowell's. It was really exciting for a kid.
Philip Crabe started out as a busboy at McDowell's in 1934. A dozen years later, he became general manager and co-owner of the famous restaurant at Main and Chippewa.
If you come in off of Main Street and go in the coffee shop entrance, the bakery department would be on the right as you went in, and the soda fountain would be on the left. We had a very complete line of baked goods. They were baked fresh daily. You would go into the main dining room that seated about 220 people, and the original drum bar was at one end of the dining room. It was a huge drum, half drum, and was used as a service bar and served all kinds of top drinks all the time.
We as waitresses had to train for months before you were allowed to wait on customers. And it was amazing. I think what made McDowell so special was the versatility of the restaurant itself, the soda fountain, booths. It just satisfied any taste.
Yeah, this is an old menu, which was done right at the restaurant. This whole menu was for $1. It's just unbelievable, a full course menu like that. Include a broiled club steak, broiled scallops with bacon, full course dinner for $1. I like to find that today.
Now this is a kiddies menu from McDowell's. And some of the items on are a mother goose, and that's 80 cents. And that's assorted fruit plate or a hamburger, vegetable plate. They have a little Raggedy Ann for 65 cents, Chickenella King for 85 cents.
Well, everything was made from scratch. We had a fantastic chocolate eclair. We had fruit tarts.
And they have the most delightful pastries. They had an eclair in Napoleons, which I don't think anyone even makes Napoleons today. They were just wonderful.
We all went to our neighborhood houses. If you had a nickel, you went to the nickel theater. If you had a dime, you went to the dime theater. And if you had a quarter, which you never did, you went to the bigger house, you know. And once a year, when your father had enough money, you came downtown to the theater.
I miss all of the film theaters that used to be in downtown Buffalo. There were so many you could go to.
The Century Theater, the old Hippodrome, the Great Lakes, the Tech, those were along Main Street.
When we arrived from New York City in 1940, one of the biggest surprises we had was hearing that there were 63 theaters in Buffalo. because for some reason or other, we didn't think of Buffalo as being big enough to have that many theaters.
The theaters were elegant. I'd go in and it would be these heavy maroon curtains hanging along the sides, and then he had these kind of long lights. I remember these smoking loges, but in those days, they also had the cigarette girls walking around with kind of skimpy outfits selling cigarettes. And I remember one, she did say this, she said, "Cigars, cigarettes, small loans." I said, "Yeah, I'll take a small loan here."
By the 40s, it went silent. And by the 40s, nobody was playing an organ anymore.
There was another theater on Delaware Avenue called the Erlanger, which is across the street from the Statler. It's now called Erlanger Place, as a matter of fact. And I think the Erlanger Theater saw probably about the last of vaudeville, because the bills were such that there would be a motion picture, but then there would also be stage productions.
At the Erlanger Theater, they were bragging about the fact that three of the Barrymores were there at one time in Rasputin. Now, I didn't have the pleasure of seeing them there, but oh, how many we did see. Katharine Hepburn, Van Heflin, Tyrone Power. Ah, I could go on forever.
They said that one time or another, most any young man in school in Buffalo skipped school on a Friday afternoon to go down to see the new show at the Palace. Now, whether that's true or not, I don't know.
I ran into the gentleman that lived next door. I had great fear that he was going to tell my father about this, you know, and naturally, about 2 days later, he saw me on the street, and he said, "Oh," he said, "Mel," he said, "you know, I just had to go in there on some business when I was in the Palace." He said, I hope you wouldn't say anything to my wife about this."
Downtown Buffalo attracted large crowds to its glamorous night spots, whether it be for prom night or just a night on the town. Bob Cranston, who's been mixing it up for the past four decades, remembers his first job at Harry Altman's popular Town Casino.
Our friends from the Tundra of the North came down, people from Toronto, Rochester, and Southern Tier. They all came because they knew they could have fun. Ladies' night was great. Monday was ladies' night, three shows, and they were all packed. It was no cover, no minimum.
It was elaborate, plush. It had velvet carpeting on the wall, and it had different tiers of sitting. And there wasn't a bad place in the theater to see talent.
We had a broadcast from the Town Casino, and we did a show every night on the air from 11 until 2 a.m. And of course, a large part of the broadcast was interviews with the stars.
Mr. Altman had such a knack of bringing people in like Johnny Mathis, Connie Francis, Bobby Rydell, Andy Williams.
You could tell it was going to be a good night because the line would go from the casino all the way up to Tupper, down Tupper to Washington, Washington to St. Michael's, and it was loaded 3-4 abreast.
When our prom date would take us there, of course, we were all dressed up, and we had our prom dates would buy us corsages, and then just before we ate dinner, we'd take a picture there, and then we'd say, "Oh, here we are again."
Harry Altman was known not only for his Town Casino, but the Glen Casino in Williamsville.
At the Glen, it was like a combination of Fantasy Island and Erie County Fair. Games galore, rides for the kids. Around 1:30, they'd have a show, freebie. Get into the old bar and sit down at a table. The guys would be peddling beer. They'd have hot dogs, hamburgers.
Oh, the Chesame was probably the prime nightclub in those days. They had the revolving bar. They did a very large Canadian business. Phil Amagon was the owner. He owned the place. When he first opened back in those days, the prime saying was that every drink was 50 cents.
A night on the town could never be complete without the exciting performances of the great black entertainers. And the place to be was at Ann Montgomery's Little Harlem at Michigan and William. Her husband, Paul Woodson, also recalls the appearance of white performers at this popular night spot.
Ann told me years ago that when I first met her, she said that Paul Whiteman had come down there and Martha Raye came in. As people would play at the town casino and the bars and the theaters up and down Main Street, they would come to Little Harlem at nighttime after the show was over, and they'd come to the cabaret. During the time that I was there, we used to have different women's clubs would come in and rent the back room for Saturday night or Sunday night, and they would put on a cabaret. Most of your notable people, that politicians and educators and whatnot, came through there. There's any number of entertainers, Sammy Davis, Lena Horne, Elvis Fitzgerald was there, Cab Calloway. He would do an engagement in Buffalo, or maybe even in Toronto. He would come back through here and stop at Little Harlem. King Cole was a very congenial person. He's an easy mixer. He blended right in with everybody, you know? And Sammy Davis was the same way. He'd come in. He liked Chinese food. At that time, we had a Chinese chef there, and he liked Chinese food. We did have a very good kitchen there for a while. You try to compare these prices with today's prices, and you were saying they were just giving food away in those days. During those days, they used to have people lined up out on the sidewalk. They're trying to get in the cabaret on the weekends for the entertainment back there. We had an eight-piece band in the back room, and we were very rigid on controlling the behavior of people in there. So they felt when they came into Little Harlem, they felt safe. Of course, we had number 4 police station right across the street, so that helped out.
We'll be back shortly with a look at some old breweries, a bustling Niagara Falls neighborhood of yesterday, and some great sports memories from Offerman Stadium and War Memorial.